know.
A bunch of things I want to look at today. But but this question is the important one for today. What's a one-hole context in some data structure built by a polynomial? Let's have a quick recap. We said that this type mu, it's parameterized by a polynomial, and the polynomial characterizes the possible node structures of the data, where the polynomial operator plus lets you offer a choice of structures, and times lets you ask for a pair of structures, and then you can have empty things, impossible things, or boring things, but 0 and 1. And the variables in the polynomial stand for substructures. So we were able to see that we built natural numbers from the polynomial, which is the constant true, which we think of as 1, plus the variable. That's to say, you either have a boring 0 or you have a successor with 1 recursive position. And then we were able to build binary trees in the same sort of way. We're offering a choice between either a leaf or some sort of branching structure with 2 recursive positions. And our program that interprets polynomials says, if you know how to interpret the variables, move it down nearer me because I'm short. If we know how to interpret the variables, then we know how to interpret polynomials, and all you do is turn the red things that make polynomials into the blue things or defined things that make the types themselves. So all we've done is written a little language and an interpreter for it, except that instead of interpreting the language as programs, we're interpreting the language as types. And then we also do things like interpret the language as programs that work using the types to say things like, well, every polynomial actually gives us a functor, and we can use, we can implement the map operation for that functor. Then, how do we build recursive data structures from a polynomial? Well, one node of a recursive data structure is built by interpreted, you wrap up a structure that's built by interpreting the polynomial, but how do you interpret the variables? You interpret them as recursive substructures. So we're saying you build one node of a mu p by interpreting the polynomial p, treating recursive substructures as more mu p's. Okay? So the question I want to look at today is how to represent a notion of one-hole context in such a structure. So let's suppose we do have binary trees. We might have a binary tree which looks like, I don't know, something. It's going to have some leaves. So we could, that's a binary tree with leaves. Imagine we were building a binary tree editor that allowed us to wander about from place to place inside the binary tree, so that at any given point we're visiting one subtree. Let's suppose we're visiting this subtree. Here's my question. How do you represent the rest of the structure? If we wanted to say, how do I represent what's inside this? Of course, I can't draw over this thing, but what's inside this kind of chevron-shaped red thing? What's the type of those? If we know the polynomial P, which generates the original data structure, can we figure out how to generate this structure? Well, let's have some clues here. First of all, if we're visiting some substructure, there's a path that takes us back from the substructure we're visiting to the root. So let me draw that path in green. This is the path from this place we're visiting. So this is going to, we're going to represent a tree with a hole, and here's the hole, and this is the subtree in the hole. We at least have to represent the path from the hole back to the root. But that's not all. That's not enough to tell us what the rest of the tree is. You can see that we also have to remember the other stuff that is hanging off to the side of the path. We have to remember that, as well as that we came from the right subtree here, we have to remember what was on the left. And here, as well as remembering that we came from the left subtree, we have to remember what was on the right. And then here, We have to remember, as well as that we came from the right subtree, we have to remember what was on the left. So there's some structure which packs up, you can see here is a whole tree, and here is a whole tree, and here is a whole tree. So there's some structure that represents layers in this one whole context. A layer in a one whole context contains the whole trees that we're not visiting, as well as enough information to determine whether we went left or right. And then a one whole context is a list of those layers. Okay? So let's get this right. Maybe I'll actually do this further up. I'll do it just under tree. So we're interested in saying that a context takes a poly one, and we get back the type of the one whole contexts. And a context for P is going to be a list of something. And it's actually going to be a list of layers. And layer is going to turn poly one into another poly one. Layer P is what? Okay, and then what's going to happen? We're going to interpret the layer P polynomial, I've got a little file before I do that, as a data structure that describes one layer of this picture, and then the variables are going to stand for whole subtrees, the subtrees we're not visiting. So that means each variable is a mu p. So now we need to figure out, how do we calculate from the original polynomial what the structure of the layers are? If you think about it, what's going on is that each layer selects a recursive substructure to visit and cuts it out. But we have to remember all of the other substructures. So what we have to do is encode the ways to put our finger over one of the variables in the polynomial and remember all the other variables. We'll do the example of binary trees in a moment, but let's just work through the logic of this. So the question is, to build a layer, we have to find a variable to put our finger over. There has to be a recursive substructure that we're cutting out. Okay. So, suppose our polynomial says, suppose it is just a variable. That says, we have exactly, our superstructure consists of exactly one recursive substructure. Can we choose a recursive substructure? Yes, there's one. There's one way to do it. We're right here. There's only one choice. And we don't need to remember any other information because all there was to it was that recursive substructure. So I'm going to say that's const true. That's the thing that gets interpreted as one. Okay, suppose our node structure is just a constant. It's either 0 or 1. Can we find a substructure in that? No, we can't. That's basically like saying, can we find a number smaller than 0? Is there another number packed up inside 0? Is there another tree packed up inside a leaf? No, there isn't. So we better say that if the original node structure is a constant, there's no way to put our finger over a substructure. So that's going to be the constant false, which gets interpreted as zero. Okay. Next, suppose there are two ways that we can make a node structure. Nodes are either P's or Q's. Then what can a layer look like? Well, if the original tree is either a P or a Q, then the structure of a layer is going to be the appropriate layer for a P or the appropriate layer for a Q. Let's suppose we had trees which could either branch in two, could either fork into two subtrees or in three. Then at each layer, we are either building a layer inside a two-way fork or a layer inside a three-way fork. So that's layer P. This comes clearer when you see examples, which we will have for the binary trees in just a moment. Now, here's the kicker. If we're building a layer for something that's built from a pair of a P and a Q, so remember the game is put your finger over one recursive substructure, right? This thing, the data here are built from pairs of P's and Q's. We have to put our finger over one recursive substructure. How can we do it? Well, there's two possibilities. If the whole thing is a pair of a P and a Q, then our selected substructure must either be inside the P or it must be inside the Q. Like here, we had pairs of substructures and we were choosing either the left one or the right one. So whenever you see a pair, that's where we've got a choice of the path to the substructure. So it's going to be something or something. But remember, we also have to keep track of all of the other data. So if we're selecting a substructure of the P, we have to remember all of the Q. Yeah? So we can have one choice is that we've got a layer inside a P and a fully intact Q. We put our finger over one of the things inside the P, and so we didn't in the Q. The Q survived intact. And then the other option is that we kept the P intact and we put our finger over one of the substructures inside the Q. Okay. Yes?
What will happen then with the plus prime when you have both P and Q when you put them?
Well, so this says the original structure is either a P or a Q, so we have to remember that either it was a P and we found a substructure, or it was a Q and we found a substructure. But each node is not both a P and a Q. Each node is definitely one or the other. Okay, so let's actually do this operation. I know that font is tiny, but hopefully the output will be large. If I do this function to the tree polynomial, let's see what comes out. Can you read this? Yeah. Yeah. So we're saying, how do we find a subtree within a tree? So we've got here, because trees are leaves or nodes, we either have a subtree in a leaf or a subtree in a node. But hey, it's actually impossible to have a subtree in a leaf. And then, because nodes are made from pairs of subtrees, we either find the left subtree and remember the right one, or we find the right subtree and remember the left one. Okay, so let's just see what happened there, doing a bit of, because there's some algebraic simplification didn't happen there, right? So tree P, if I write it down in more mathematical notation, tree P of X, I just think of it as a polynomial in a variable. It's 1 plus x squared. Yeah? You can see 1 plus variable times variable. Now, what happened with layer? We got 0 plus 1 times x plus x times 1, which simplifies to x plus x, or if you like, 2 times x. Yeah? What would have happened if instead of working with binary trees, we worked with trees that fork three ways each time? So, ternary P, poly 1, ternary P is same thing. Right. What's a layer in a ternary P? What do you think it is? Nodes in ternary trees have three subtrees. How do you record a layer? You've got to remember which of the three subtrees you chose, and you have to remember the other two subtrees. Yeah? So out comes this thing, which again I will simplify algebraically, and we'd have to write out this picture. So that was ternary, I'll just write ter of x is 1 plus x cubed. Layer in a ternary tree of x's, what has it told us? We've got 0 plus what? 1 times x squared, more brackets required, plus x times, and then the thing we had before, 1 times x plus x times 1. Okay, let's simplify that. We can drop the 0 plus, so it's 1 plus x squared plus x times 2x, which is, sorry, that's 1 times x squared, which is x squared plus 2 times x squared, which is 3 times x squared. That's to say, a choice of three ways we could go, and but also remembering the other two subtrees. Now, have you ever seen a mathematical operation in your lives, maybe searching back into the dim and distant past of high school mathematics, that turns 1 plus x cubed into 3x squared, that turns 1 plus x squared into 2x? Yeah! It's any time you've got like something like, I don't know, x to the n, that means you've got an n tuple of x's. And what you've got to do is pick one and then remember the other n minus one. So you've got a choice of n paired with x to the n minus one. It's doing exactly the same thing as symbolic differentiation. So I'm going to do a search and replace to turn layer into diff. So in fact, you can see this is these are the laws for symbolic differentiation. You know, how do you take the derivative of p plus q? That's the sum of the derivatives. How do you take the derivative of p times q? That's the derivative of p times q plus p times the derivative of q. But really, it's like, how do you make a hole in a thing? How do you make a hole in a pair of a p and a q? You either make the hole in the p and leave the q alone, or you leave the p alone and you make the hole in the q. So this operation that we're used to being about, kind of tangents of curves and rates of change and all of that sort of stuff, has a perfectly sensible meaning as making holes in data structures. This program was essentially written in pretty much this form in the 17th century by Leibniz. I'm not sure Newton did it quite as neatly, but but he did something similar around the same time. And if I switch to the document camera for a moment, it's actually a pretty old computer program. Let's find it. Here we go. This is a program for symbolic differentiation. It's got six lines. It says, so it takes as its parameters the formula and the variable. And it says things like, if you're taking the derivative of u plus v with respect to x, that's the derivative of u with respect to x plus the derivative of v with respect to x. It's, everything's in prefix operators. And here's that rule for products. If you're taking the derivative of u times v, that's u times the derivative of v plus v times the derivative of u. So modulo, switching the order of some pluses and some timeses, that's the same program. This program was implemented in the late 1960s and is the first example of pattern matching in my father's PhD thesis. My father invented pattern matching in the late 1960s and didn't tell anybody. Well, he told Tony Hoare, but round about the same time, my PhD supervisor, Rod Burstall, also invented the case expression, but that was an on-paper thing. Nobody was running case expressions, whereas this stuff really ran on computers in the late 60s, early 70s. It wasn't until 1980 when the programming language HOPE was implemented in Edinburgh that the rest of the world was actually running pattern matching programs. And then that turned into ML, which grew into Haskell that we have now. And indeed, stuff like Agda. So, my father left his toys around when I was six, didn't tidy them up properly, and I kind of got stuck into them when I was rather small. So I learned lambda calculus and differential calculus at the same time, because I was doing functional programming with this stuff. So that's some story about how I got to be the sick bastard I am today. And also why the person who noticed that this notion of one whole context was given by exactly symbolic differentiation was, of course, me. And so let's see if we can actually build some useful operations with this. So one thing we ought to do is we ought to be able to say that if we have a one whole context and we have something that would go in the hole, we ought to be able to rebuild the original structure. So let's write a thing called plug. We've got a P in poly one, and there'll be some set X. If we have something which interprets the variables as X's and our structure is a diff P, and we have, I'll put the X first, in fact I'll separate these out over some lines. So if we have a P with a hole whose recursive positions, a P with a hole whose recursive positions are occupied by X's, and we have an X to put in the hole, we ought to be able to make a P, an entire P, whose elements are X's. So let's see that cash out in practice. We've got an x, we've got a p with a hole, and we're trying to make a p without a hole. We're clearly going to have to look at p to figure out what's going on. Right. So what have we here? Our polynomial consists of a single variable. That's to say, in the thing we're trying to make, there's exactly one place to put an element. You can see that our context information, our p with a hole, is trivial. And we have an element ready to go in the hole. Put it in a hole. Okay, in this situation, our polynomial has no positions to put any elements. So how on earth are we going to plug an element into a position? Well, fortunately for us, our one-hole context structure is impossible. That's what we said when we said that constants have zero derivative. So we can just say, this can't be happening to me. Okay. So now what happens? Our overall node structure is either a P or a Q. We're supposed to make either a P or a Q. We've got a context structure, which tells us that we either have a P with a hole or a Q with a hole. So when we look at our context structure, we see it tells us we're either in left or in right. So what have we here? We have here, we in this case, we have a P with a hole. So that means if we're going to give back a P or a Q, our only chance is to say, I'm going to give back a P. I've got a P with a hole and a thing to put in the hole. I can do a plug for a P with X and P prime. And then the same thing happens on the other side. If we had a Q with a hole, then we'd better make a Q without a hole. We go right. Okay. Now what happens in the fun case? We're supposed to make a pair of a P and a Q. And we have either a P with a hole and a Q, or a P and a Q with a hole. So we better see where the thing is. It's either on the left or on the right. If it's on the left, then we have a P with a hole and a Q. If it's on the right, we have a P and a Q with a hole. Oh, better, it's not liking that. That's legit. I'm going to call these things, I'm going to stick X's everywhere, because their structure's full of X's. I shouldn't have made that, just that. Right, stop moaning now. Okay. So, what's my sub-problem here? I've got to make a P and a Q. I've got a P with a hole and a Q fully intact. So step one, exploit that I have a fully intact Q. Step two, build an intact P by plugging an X into my P with a hole. So plug it in when the context says go left, we plug in on the left. And guess what? When the context says go right, we've already got the thing fully intact that goes on the left, and we do our plugging in on the right. So the data type given by symbolic differentiation really tells us how to find our way to the place where we're going to plug in the extra thing. And any time there was a choice, right? There's only a choice when we were building structures from pairs. It's only when there's a pair of things that you've got a choice of whether the hole is on the left or on the right. And there we exactly have the information to tell us which side the hole was on and all the rest of the information we need to rebuild the rest of the structure. So we were able to write that plugging in operation. And with that, we ought to be able to write something called plugs, which takes, for all p in poly 1, a whole p and a context for a p, and builds a whole p again. So this is plug the subtree into its context to make a whole tree. Okay, so what have we got? I think our lists these days are encoded. Yeah, they are. I'll tell you what I'll do. Time is short. I'll write that manually as list and t prime cons t primes. Okay. So remember, a context is a list of layers. We're trying to plug the subtree into the context. So in the nil case, we are saying there are no layers surrounding the whole. That means that the tree we need to build by plugging T into the whole is exactly T. Okay? Now, in the step case, we're supposed to plug in T into a context, which is a list of layers, where we've got T prime, that is the layer nearest us, and then T primes are all the rest of the layers on the way back out to the root of the structure. So we're going to have to do some plugging with structure P of something. We're going to have to build a layer, you know, do one layer of wrapping, and then plug that into the rest of the context. So what is one layer of wrapping? Well, it's built like that. And now let's see what we've got. We've got a P with a hole. We're trying to build one node structure of a P. We've got a thing to go in the hole. Unfortunately, the variables are now interpreted as trees. So I can say that's plug P T T prime. Plugging the subtree into its whole context is just repeatedly using this one layer plug operation to build up the resulting tree a layer at a time. So this is like we're basically moving outward through the tree structure. It's like if we have a cursor visiting a subtree, we are repeatedly doing the sort of cursor move outward step until we reach all the way to the root. So we can represent a tree that we're editing by a pair of these things. By the subtree we're visiting and its context. And this operation represents the kind of go to the root edit move. Just by rebuilding the original tree from its context. So this is this is a world of entertainment and curiosity. Who knew that, you know, a lump of calculus that, you know, people thought was, you know, about, you know, figuring out the trajectories to put people on the moon or whatever it happened to be, was going to sort of show up as an operation for building the right data structures required for navigating around inside data types. That was a lot of fun figuring this stuff out. I remember actually. So I thought this was the first intelligent thought I had after I finished my PhD. Basically, I submitted my PhD. My brain stopped working for a year and a half, and then this is the thing I spotted. This was the thing that happened when my brain suddenly started working again, and it was just a relief, apart from anything else, and as well as slightly terrifying. No one tells you that when you do a PhD, your brain stops working for a while, but I can assure you it is a temporary phenomenon. It's a fun thing when it kicks back in again. Where am I going from here? Because I've got not very many minutes. I want to ask a different question, which is, we've basically seen two ways recently of talking about tree-like structures, one of which is to build polynomials. That's what we've been doing in lectures. And what you've been working with in exercises is to use these container-like structures which characterize the ways in which you can build trees as how do you cut up, what are the ways to cut up a problem, and into what pieces do you cut it? I wonder if I've just got enough time to write this program. Let's see if we're lucky. Oh dear.
Where did all that go?
Well, my comedy file is switched off, so I better do that manually. Can we translate a polynomial into one of these container-like things where there's only one sort of structure and one sort of piece? Does a polynomial give us a way of cutting stuff up? Sure enough, and yes, it does. So we need to figure out how to characterize the shape of a node structure, and then given the shape, how to figure out what positions it has. One way to characterize the shape of a structure given by a polynomial is simply to give the data for a polynomial to evaluate it.
What's gone wrong here? I have to give a get one of those.
And then just use dummies for the positions. We're not going to say what's in the positions. We're just going to say that they exist. So it's just like, think about lists. What determines the shape of a list? What determines the number of positions in a list? That's just the length of the list, right? A list of elements of one is basically a number. Instead of actual elements, you've just got void, sitting in each place where there could be an element. So the shape of these things is always given by evaluation at one. How about the positions? We get an index and we get a shape, I think. Or maybe that's implicit. What we got here? Right. So if somebody tells me the shape, I've got to give a list of the positions. I wonder if I've got time to do this, but we'll see what happens. we look at the polynomial, I'll get this case done. It's a variable. The variable tells me that the data structure better have one position. The shape is boring. What I'm going to say is, given that the polynomial says there ought to be some data, the resulting structure better have a position. So I give back a singleton list. Now let's think about pairing, but I don't think I've got the right operation defined. If our structure is supposed to be a pair of a P and a Q, what are the positions? Well, there are going to be some positions in the P, and there are going to be some positions in the Q. I've got a P shape and a Q shape. The positions in the whole thing are going to be given by concatenating the positions in the left, on the left-hand side, with the positions on the right-hand side. So if I only had, I don't think I've got a concatenation operator defined, but I could calculate the positions on the, for the left shape and the positions on the right shape, and those would be lists, and I could append them, and that would give me the positions in the whole thing. We can also say that if we've got a constant as the shape, then there are definitely no positions inside. So there's a deep relationship between these polynomial things and these container-like structures. Containers are a particular normal form for polynomials. And it's useful that they have that, right? Anyway, it's time I stopped. We've got 2 weeks to go. So my plan is to set exercise 3 this weekend and then figure out what I need to spend the next fortnight teaching. But it might well involve syntax. I mean, that's to say, it might well involve building programming languages, so modeling their syntax and modeling interpreters for them. But now we've just seen, we've got the technology, once we know the tree structure of the syntax, to think about how we might navigate around that tree structure and edit programs. So hopefully it'll all come together. Anyway, have a great weekend. See you on Tuesday.